Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Sunday worship service on the 5th of May, 2024 at and coming to you from Broadway First Baptist Church here in Winnipeg. My name is Paul Gittle, and I'm your service host today. Participating and contributing directly to this time together, we have Carrie Denby on the organ and piano, with her husband Steve on guitar, Margaret Mitchell reading scripture, Bob Griffin together with John Hunt leading us in communion, and today's communion will be the message. We thank Sheila for being the Zoom host with her technical expertise and Alan McCracken on security. Raymond Sikalski has been an essential and integral part of today's service in coordinating with our participants to produce the bulletin wherein it all comes together for this time of organized worship and fellowship. Raymond has another event that he's attending this morning, but he hopes to be here at some point in our time together. I do have a few announcements, but first I'd like to ask John Hunt to come up and share what is happening with bulletin projection concepts. John?
Thank you, Paul. The bulletin. The bulletin creation begins probably around Monday, sometimes Tuesday, sometimes Wednesday, and it really is a great tool for us to map out where we're going with the service. And often it's not completed until Friday, Saturday, and it gets a little bit complicated on how we physically get it here for you. So we're going to try a few new things, and the first one was done today, and it was projected at the beginning of the service. We recognize that although it was an interesting thing to look at, it's not going to work as a long-term thing. So we're going to try a few different things, and one of them that to keep in mind is that there is always a copy on the website that can be printed. It can also be brought up live on your phone. So just look for some evolution of this. And what we're trying to do is during these days of struggling with timelines and getting this here and avoiding the frustration for you when you don't have a bulletin at the beginning of service. So just a heads up that we're working through some changes on this. Thank you.
Thank you, John. A reminder that Pastor Charlene is away in Ontario at her mom's, and we pray God's blessing upon her and her family. A reminder that we will have a benevolent offering following communion today. And next Sunday, the 12th of May, following the service, we will be having a potluck lunch downstairs in Friendship Hall. Bring your appetite. Our call to worship scripture is 1 Peter 2, verse 9, where we read, "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light." Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, as we gather here together as a congregation, we do so in the knowledge that you both grant and impart that it is you who have chosen us and brought us out of the darkness into your marvelous light, and that you have done so that we shall praise you and proclaim your holy word, all to your good pleasure. We ask that your spirit would be here in abundance, flowing to us and spilling over from us as we sing and as we worship you and hear your word and pray. May our voices blend in holy harmony, and may the music resonate together to your glory and honor, for it is in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is found in your Book of Praise, number 363, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." Baptist hymnal number three. No, correction on bulletins. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Going to have a children's story this morning, but I'll tell you a little story about that particular hymn. I was reading about that hymn, and there was a missionary in India in the 1700s, and he was in distress and he was being pursued by some tribes with spears that were out to get him. And as they were approaching, he took out his violin and he began to play All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. And when he got to that stanza where he says, "Let every kindred and every tribe These people that were approaching him to kill him stopped. They broke down in tears. And it came to pass that he actually ended up ministering to them in his mission work. So the name of Jesus is a very powerful name. So that's the children's story for all you grown-ups. Our lead-in scripture to the prayers of God's people comes from Hebrews chapter 10. We've got verse 19 written down, and I'm going to read it up to verse 23. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Would you join me in prayer? Our loving Heavenly Father, we praise you for your determined and courageous, loving resolve. A resolve that had you coming into this fallen world on that first Christmas, knowing the cross was coming, and still you came, and you died for us while we were yet sinners. And so, as we enter into your holy presence by the precious blood of Jesus, we do so with awe and wonder and both humility and confidence, knowing you opened this singular way into your presence, apart from which we would have no standing whatsoever with you. And yet now, being able to commune with you, we ask that your word and your spirit would inspire and guide our prayer and our worship. We thank you for the great gift of life and of being sentient. And we thank you for the surpassing gift of salvation, a salvation you and you alone and you alone could provide and have provided. Teach us your ways, O Lord, so different than the world's. We ask you to increase our sensitivity to the reality of your Holy Spirit's presence in our lives and help us to yield to your Lordship in all things and at all times. We pray for the work of your Spirit in this church and ask for your hands to be upon all aspects of our mission as proclaimers of the biblical gospel that calls all peoples everywhere to repent. We pray for the administration and the finances, the practical things that seek work done on the roof and the boiler and the plumbing. Convict us, Father, when we have allowed secular agendas to intrude and displace and distract us from your call. May you continue to create new creatures in Christ as you transform lives among us and we become radiant vessels of your Holy Spirit's presence wherever your leading takes us. We pray your blessing upon the ladies' retreat in Elkhorn this weekend. May their time together be encouraging and edifying as they gather around your all-sufficient, complete, holy word. Grant journeying mercies and journeying joy as they travel back to their homes later today. Bless Pastor Charlene and her family, and bless her time with her mom in Ontario. Thank you, Father, for the lengthening of daylight hours as spring unfolds, with the promise of blossoms, all fragrant and colorful, and baby animals, birds, geese and goslings, duck and ducklings, deer and fawns on warming days. We acknowledge your creative, redeeming love, and that you, Lord, are the author of the seasons. We pray for our church and extended church families. We pray for the children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren out in the world with so many things happening and competing for their attention and their alliance. Help us to pray with confidence in the mighty name of Jesus Christ as we bring them all before you in prayer, asking you to watch over them, to protect, redirect, and direct them. Call them to your word and empower them to say no to that which is misleading, unholy, unhealthy, destructive, and dangerous. Help them and us to avail ourselves of the resilient armor that you are able to provide. We thank you for the word of God, sword of the Spirit. Bless all who proclaim your holy word with integrity and energy as they seek to share in the wonderful realities and promises of the living and loving holy God that you are. Continue to bring comfort, consolation, and reassurance to those who've experienced loss. And we think of the Stevenson family, the Donnelly family, the Hart family, the Barber family, and the friends and family of Betty Chalmers. We pray, Father, for our shut-ins and their caregivers. We pray for those that are dependent upon medical care and home care. We pray for the integrity of those who serve in those capacities, that they would be called by your Spirit and doing things as unto you and not unto their worldly masters, that they would be doing so with sensitivity, compassion, and thoughtful remembrance of those with whom they have been tasked to care for. Father, we pray for our nation, and as summer approaches, we know the possibility and probability of forest fires increases. So we pray that you would bless and watch over those who train to combat these fires, both on the ground and in the air. Give them the skill and the tools, the training, the integrity that they need to be able to do their jobs well. We also pray, Father, that you would be merciful with directing the rains appropriately to help in their task, that they would not be overwhelmed. Fathers, we pray for those in positions of power and authority over us. We ask that you will deliver us from those who promote evil, those who champion immorality and the murder of the unborn. Father, we pray, Father, for our world with its ongoing and seemingly endless conflicts. And yet, Father, we know that your kingdom advances and your Spirit is at work in people's lives. And we ask that that would continue and that you would help us to be a part of that with great hope, for our hope is in you, not in military might or political outcomes. Our greatest enemy has already been defeated, and we praise and thank you for that. And we ask, Father, that you would bless all of our hearts. Reign us in and reign in us with Christ as Lord of all and enthroned in our hearts. Bless us as we continue to worship during this special sacred hour. We ask all of these things in the strong and victorious and powerful name of our triumphant and risen Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm reading scripture today. It's a very brief passage, but a very important passage. I'm reading from 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 and 24. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for me, for you. Do this in remembrance of me." May God bless the reading of this word to our hearts.
Thank you, Margaret. And now, our hymn of approach. One bread, one body.
Thank you.
Going to ask John and Bob Griffin to come forward, and I will pray with them. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are one body in Christ who has saved us, and we pray that you will help us to serve you wholeheartedly. So I bring before you my brothers in Christ, Bob Griffin and John Hunt, and ask for your Spirit to guide and direct them and speak through them to us with what they have to say, Father, as we acknowledge our salvation and what it took on this Communion Sunday. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we start, I'm wondering, you kind, wonderful people, be so kind to come and join these kind, wonderful people. Would that be okay? Thank you. And I do want to thank you for singing Mansion Over the Hilltop. Now, every now and then, you have to go into the vault and get out those good old gospel songs and start clapping, dancing, and just having a great time. So thank you for that. I appreciate that. And I can actually hear you all the way over there, so that's a good sign. First Sunday of the month. What Sunday is it?
Communion
Sunday, isn't it Communion Sunday this Sunday? Okay, that's what the bulletin says, at least. Now, we know that our tradition here at Broadway First is that the first Sunday of every month we have communion. And I know some people think, oh my goodness, not again? Didn't we just had communion like 2 days ago? And sometimes it seems that way. And so we, every now and then, try to do something a little different, you know, to add a little bit of spice to it, to, you know, maybe leaven it up a little bit. And so far, all the little things that we have done seem to be working, like having it at a different time or doing kind of like this, two of us. But, you know, I think everything in life can be kind of blah or humbug if it doesn't have any meaning, right? Now, believe me, when we come together to do this, to have communion, there is meaning behind it. And one of the blessings that we have is that we call this the Lord's table. It's not the table of Broadway First. It's the Lord's table. So anyone is welcome to partake. You don't have to be a Baptist. Doesn't matter if you have this personal relationship with the Lord, you are welcome to join us here at this table. And Christ himself tells us that there's meaning behind this. Like, we don't just do it because we have an extra 10 minutes at the end of the service. We do it because there is meaning behind this. And Jesus himself, as we heard through the scripture, and that many of you know probably by heart, that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, broke it, says, "This is my body given to you." Do you understand the significance of that? That one statement itself? This is my body. Now, not literally his body. When we eat this, it does not become the flesh of Christ. This is a symbolic gesture of Christ's body. So Christ is saying, this is my body given to you. Again, do we really understand the significance behind that? That God, the Son, the second person of the Trinity, who loves us so much that he decided to come to this world as a baby, to die on the cross, to take himself, the sins of man upon himself, that scripture says that he who knows no sin became sin for us. Jesus didn't sin, but because of his great love for each one of us, he decided to take your sins, my sins, and put upon himself to die on the cross. This is my body given to you. And the scripture says that no greater love than this, that a man laid down his life for a friend. So when I come on the first Sunday of the month, I don't dread communion. I look forward to communion. I look forward to the time that we gather together like this, as we sing with our hearts to express our love to God, who decided that he loves us so much that he came to die for us, to give us life, to give us hope. So my thought, as we gather, let's not think of this as just another thing to do or another tradition, but think of it as something that has meaning, that brings hope in our lives. Actually, I've known some people when they take part in communion that actually cried during communion because of the significance behind this. But this is what Christ did for us. God, who knew no sin? Wow. There's lots of significance behind that. So as we gather here today, as we take part in the bread, let us remember that he gave his body, put on the cross for us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this church family. I thank you that even though we may not be a large group, we are a group that has love for one another, a group that's willing to serve one another. But most important is a group that loves you, Lord. And so as we gather this morning, seeing the bread, when we eat it, let us remember that you give your body to die on the cross for us. And that we just don't do this because we have an extra 10 minutes. We do it because we want to remember your great sacrifice, your great love for us, that you are so willing to die for us. And I thank you. In the name of Christ, amen. Thank you. the body of Christ given to you, let us eat in remembrance of him.
Well, thank Bob for your thoughts on and prayer for the first element of communion, the body of Christ broken for us. I had a very interesting week preparing for today. In fact, my words come to you in the wake of a frustrating couple of weeks. In November, I organized a paving operations training seminar for the 6 largest asphalt paving companies in Manitoba, and it happened last week, and it consumed the majority of the last 2 weeks in preparation for and then serving the needs of this training group that I brought in from Southern Ontario. And surprisingly enough, the demands continued right into this weekend, because Friday afternoon I got a phone call from one of the trainers based out of Toronto saying that he'd left his wallet in the restaurant down by Seasons of Tuxedo and asked me to go get it on Friday night and courier it to him in Kempville, which I'm not able to do until Monday, so it was very interesting. But the point of all that is that the performance of the Western region for the company that I work for relies on our success, really relies on me and a group of people who sell machines. And I just took 2 weeks out of my selling year and sold nothing. And I've come here frustrated, or in the lead up to this, I was frustrated anyway, and worn out, and I'm certainly way behind in what I have to do for the next little while here. And I'm telling you this because it's important to acknowledge some things as we come together in worship. And one of them is, I like to acknowledge where we are. We're in the presence of the Lord, the corner of Walnut and Honeyman, and Wolseley, Winnipeg, Manitoba, Treaty 1. And another thing it's important to acknowledge is what we've brought here with us. Sin, stress, could be peace and health. Could be sickness, worry, and it can be joy. So as we gather at the table of our Lord for communion, it's also good to acknowledge to ourselves, if not to everybody, the distractions that fill our mind and separate us from God. So this is a communion table, and by definition, that means a place to exchange intimate thoughts and feelings of spiritual nature. So I've come here this week distracted, and it could prevent me from getting the most out of communion with you. And that's really too bad. April, last month, last communion, that was different. By that, I mean the distractions were different. And I don't think I made the most out of communion in April. Same thing with March, another missed opportunity for some reason. Now February, I don't remember, but I think there was probably something bugging me that day as well. And I've probably been here for far too many communions that I didn't fully take part in, even though I tried to and thought that I had. And I didn't know it at the time, but I really came to the realization this week as I was thinking about this, that, again, we need to acknowledge that we live in lives of distraction. And the distractions may be what happened before today. Sometimes the distraction is what you think is going to happen when the service is over, what you're going to next. That could be downstairs here, or it could be at home. And it's an interesting thing about God in our lives, that God could demand our attention, but God doesn't. God is waiting for us to give it to him. Same thing with this communion table. God is waiting for us to come to him in communion. So, do you know what you're bringing to this table this week? It's a pretty fine question. And is that keeping you from true communion? And if you don't know what's distracting you, I hope that you can come to an understanding soon. And it's good to be suddenly aware, suddenly made aware. And I hope it helps you to hear about my shortcomings. And last week, I had a moment of awareness. I'm looking over here because... Before service began last week, Carrie asked what the buzzing in the sanctuary was. And I thought, well, maybe it's the lights, maybe it's that projector up there. I listened hard, but I really didn't hear it. And somewhere during the service, I thought about her question, and the buzzing came to the forefront. And it did so in the middle of Hank's sermon, and I could barely hear him for those doggone lights that were buzzing. And even though it's been there all the time, and I just wasn't paying it any attention, and if it wasn't a top-notch sermon, I would have probably missed much of it. So we could all use a person like Carrie in our lives who can point something out that we've stopped paying attention to, and something that makes us wake up. And please don't bother paying attention to that one buzzing light. I thought we were... isolating the buzzers, but apparently they're all buzzing. So that's what this focus on communion really is about. It's moving it to the start of the service, which we've done the last two communions, and this week making it the service in the hope that we can all be aware of it in a new way. So since I mentioned Hank's sermon last week, I'd like to bring last week and this week together in a little way. So Hank Dixon gave us a lot to talk about last week. He was talking about how Christians age, and he titled the sermon, The Age Debate. I listened to it again on Monday on YouTube, and you should think about doing the same thing, especially if you didn't hear the sermon. He talked about the change in perspective of a Christian through the years and what maturity brings to a relationship with God. He also said that true faith is the ability to stay the course over a long period of time. And as I took in that sermon, I actually heard it through the filter of this week and the filter of communion and how age and maturity has changed the way I approach the table. And I was thinking about today in anticipation of today, and it was really helpful. So I'm just going to spend a little bit of time on how I've experienced communion through the years. So when I was young, communion was always something that I watched. The plates went in front of me. So my mother did not approve of young, unbaptized people taking communion without understanding. And so the plates, they just went past me. And I see my dad's on under Mary's iPad. My dad is here today, but I assume he was fully aware of this, although I just assume that father does what mother supports what mother says, so maybe or maybe not, eh, Dad? So one Sunday, my friend Alan, I've talked about Alan many times, he came to church with us. Now, his family never went to church, but he was curious about what we did there. He watched us go every Sunday, and he got there on a communion Sunday. So when communion started around noon, he whispered over to me, "What's happening?" So I had to tell him, "There's bread and juice coming."
"Good, I'm getting hungry."
So he was not impressed with the portion size, but he did share in communion, and he did so years before I did because he didn't have to answer to mother's rules. So I wasn't baptized in this corner over here until 1998, when I was 31 years old. And sometime before that, I had gone against mother's wishes and had been taking communion. And I was certainly at that time getting something out of it. By the time I became a deacon in 2010, I had opinions about how how communion could be better. And so when it was my time to prepare and serve the elements, I implemented one of them. And that little wee cube of white bread that sort of disappeared the moment it hit your mouth and got stuck in a tooth and, well, it didn't seem appropriate to me. And I also found out a funny thing, that when you're serving communion, some people, I didn't notice it here today, but some people take more than one piece. Orville Vokes would take a pinch of bread, and sometimes it was two, sometimes it was three, and he would get quite a few of them. So I brought a loaf of tall grass, whole wheat multigrain, cut in large squares. And as I passed the plate, there were raised eyebrows because of the size and also because it wasn't white. They weren't getting what they expected. And sorry, Pauline, to pull you out of the service, but I remember Pauline saying, "Such big pieces." So it took a long time to chew and swallow. And when we came back with the juice, there were still people processing that bread. And my thought was, good, let them chew on the body of Christ and never forget. However, the feedback afterward was such that I didn't use that bread again. However, you may have noticed today that there was an option of some bigger crusty pieces in there, which I thought I should do just in honor of what was happening here today. So the communions have rolled past in ways that I don't really remember. Sometime ago, we started inviting people to the front to come together. And that was really so that we're coming together like a family, and it's almost an act of coming to the table instead of expecting the table to come out to you. This is the third Sunday that we've had communion at the start of the service. So I want to go back to Hank's sermon for a minute here. He said that true faith is staying the course over a long period of time. And we probably all know people who have done that well. And there's a song that I always liked called Old Time Religion. You know, give me that old time religion. It's good enough for grandma, it's good enough for grandpa, and it's good enough for me. So when I think of the people who have been coming to this communion table a lot longer than me, I'm encouraged. So before, it was my grandmother. Today, it's my father. But there's also you up there. I think of Bev. Gay. Bev's not here today. Helen. Reuben and Pauline. I'm inspired to know that these smart people continue to find comfort here and keep coming to this table. And it's the same for everybody here right now. I'm glad to be living our lives of faith together and to be joining at this table. So I want to be here at this table in a way maybe that I never have been before. First of all, as an older person. But I've done my best to leave my troubles of the week outside the sanctuary so I can truly be here. And I haven't been very good at that through the years, but I was very intentional about it today. Also, I'm going to wait until I leave the sanctuary to start thinking about what I have to do later on today. But this is the big one. I will come to this table with gratitude for so many undeserved blessings in my life, and serving you today is one of them. But like Hank said, it isn't enough to do this today. This has to be committed to over and over again for a lifetime. So before we pray for the blood of Christ shed for us, I'd like to read the scripture that got me started on this. So what you just heard was nothing like what I thought I was going to say. I don't know what it was like for you, but it just the vision of where you think you're going and where you end up was a lot different this week. Today's more a result of reading this scripture that I stumbled on when I was under a lot of pressure. And I stumbled on it thanks to Bob, because when we were talking about the scripture, I texted you, as you remember, and I asked what it was, and I think you had a little typo on and ended up in the wrong verse of Corinthians. So what he inadvertently led me to was 1 Corinthians 11, 27 to 34. And in that little parcel here, it says, "So then when whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." It's sad that little things can distract us from what's really important. So communion, it either means everything or it means nothing at all. Let's pray.
Amen.
God, thank you for giving us choice to meet you at this table. Let us drink from this cup and know that you are here. Your sacrifice means everything. Help us to fully understand. Amen. Blood of Christ shed for you. Bob, what do you say we do the Lord's Prayer today?
Yeah.
All right. It was a tradition a while ago that we used to do this more often, and let's try to revive it today. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, that we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
So one of the things that John was talking about was distractions in life. And a little footnote. When I come to the table, I remember the great sacrifice that Christ has made for us. And there's times that I really need to be reminded of that. And I'm going to tell you why about distractions in life. And I personally, I need to get this story out because it's been bugging me for the last couple of days. And I don't know who to share this with. So, hey. Guess what? I'm sharing it with you guys, okay? So, I have somebody living in my, staying with me for a couple days. And the issue with this guy is addiction, okay? I don't want to get into much details. But he invited a friend of his over to my place, which is, it's okay. Now, I'm going to backtrack. I had an interesting episode of, was it a month ago? That I had this episode that threw me through for a loop, where I was basically down on my knees. I was sick, literally sick, as well as words of condemnation were thrown at me from left and right, like, you know, good, you're lousy, people dislike you, blah, 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 blah. And all this is like being drilled at me like this as I'm nearly be to fall a toilet. And then, after sharing with some people, the realization that Christ's love is much more powerful than the words of people. And I can listen to these words. I can take them to heart, or as I can take them to the cross, saying, are those not true? Because I am part of a royal family. I'm part of a family where God Almighty loves me, and that he sees me as someone of importance. So go back to this person that my friend invited over. So as we are sitting talking, she was still right at me. Now turn her head like this. Still at me and turn her head like this. And meanwhile, she's telling this guy, just look at him. Just look at him. I can't look at him. Look at that beard. Like, yeah, I know it's not the greatest. But look at that face. And she would turn. She would turn again. And that almost threw me for a loop again. Well, I had to go to my room, sit down on my chair, and I said to God, like, well, I'm not going to tell you what I said to God because it's really impolite and, you know. But the words of Christ came back to me again, that you are part of a royal family. You are a child of God Almighty who loves you, and you are somebody of importance. And I also hope that I have friends who we serve in those forces too. So, distractions in life comes. We come here, we lay them at the foot of the cross to have God wash his love over us and to receive that. We knew her in our life to know that Christ loves us, that he died for us. So we come to this table to remember that. Our last song, I know we shall all know it. When you sing it, remember the words, in Christ alone. Scripture says, Jesus himself, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the light. No one comes to the Father but through me. Only Christ could have done what he did on the cross for us. So let's stand and sing together in Christ alone. Amen. And it will be up there.
Thank you.
Well, we're at the end. There is coffee downstairs, so thanks to Lulu who led the preparation of that this morning. So maybe we'll see you downstairs. As a benediction, though, we're going to go back to an oldie. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Go out on the streets of Winnipeg, go with Christ, and know you're not alone. Amen. Amen.